Okay. All right. So what's GenderMag and where did it come from? Here's this graphic I pointed out to you before. I always show this graphic on my very first slide before I get started on anything else, because as soon as somebody hears the word gender, they might be saying, uh-oh, is this going to gender stereotype? And so this very first graphic shows that this is not about gender stereotyping. So that tends to make people relax if that's what they were primed to look for. Okay, so gender and technology, how do these relate? Keep in mind, this is I teach this to students this way, I teach this to practitioners this way, I teach it to researchers this way. And so in every case, what they're wondering about is, can I use this to make better software? Okay, so that's the question this talk is answering. So how does gender and tech relate? Well, it turns out that most tech has gender bias bugs in it. And so here's a worried software developer thinking about their incredibly full workload, and they're saying, you're kidding. Do I have something else I have to start worrying about? You know, where are these bugs? And the answer is in the tech that you are creating. By you, I mean this person. And not only that, but in the tools that you, this person, are using to do the creating. So this person is still very worried about their workload, and they're saying, well, like, do I really have to worry about this? Can I just like get out of this? And the answer is no, you can't get out of it, because this matters a lot. Every time somebody stumbles into one of these bugs, they pay a cognitive tax every single time. So the software, the technology is just sapping their strength, okay, all the way along. But even if you don't care about that, there's another reason why you would care about this. And that is, if you take down those inclusivity bugs, what you end up with is better technology, just flat out better. And so the design community is already familiar with this principle, but it turns out that when you address an underserved population segment in any product you're building, you tend to make things better for everyone. So the classic example is curb cuts. You know, those cutout places in the sidewalk? So way back in the old days, there were no curb cuts. And somebody noticed somebody in a wheelchair having to deal with situations like this. And they said, you know what, this is terrible. And curb cuts were born. Actually, it wasn't seamless. It involves Portland and a stick of dynamite and stuff. I'll tell you about that sometime if you want to know. Anyway, curb cuts were born. And they did help people in wheelchairs. Yay. And they helped people with those wheeled walkers too. And they helped parents pushing their babies in strollers. And they helped people on bicycles. And they helped people pushing heavy bales of hay on their wheeled dollies. So what we ended up with was we did not understand there was anything wrong with sidewalks until we looked at it through the eyes of this person. And then we ended up with something that was better in the eyes of everyone. Okay, so hopefully for one or another of these reasons, you're excited. But before I tell you what to do, I'm gonna have to tell you what not to do. Shrink it and pink it. Do not be doing this. This is a real thing. If you get on Google, you will find this all over the place. So at some point, here's one from back in the day, Dell's pink laptops. So some brainy person at Dell decided, you know, oh, cool, we need more money for women. Let's take our laptops and paint them pink. And not only that, we're going to come up with this cool website to go with, and it's going to have recipes. You know, it's going to be great. Okay, 2009, that's before the days of Twitter. Guess how long it took Dell to take down that embarrassing website after it went up. Remember, before the age of Twitter. Go ahead and guess. How long before they took it down in embarrassment? 20 minutes. 20 minutes before the outcry was so great and they were so embarrassed, they took it down. So we may say, okay, well, hopefully the industry has learned its lesson by now. Huh, well, let's talk about BIC for her. This too is from back in the day, but this one is still on the market. So some brainy person at BIC said, we should sell more pens to women. So we have this awesome idea. We'll come up with some pens that are pink and purple and sparkly. We'll add a label for her and we'll raise the price. Okay. So y'all know Ellen, the talk show host. Here's how she responded to that. Oh, my feeble hand. I used to have to have my husband fill out all my recipe cards for me, but now, thanks to BIC for her. Okay, so obviously this is such a bad idea, so disrespectful, so bad on so many levels, but on top of everything else, it doesn't even work, okay? Because nobody's typical. The world does not divide into typical women and men and any other gender, because being a member of some gender is a very complicated proposition. It's got a lot of variables. And so you just can't divide the world up into bins. And I showed you that on the graphic on the first slides as well. So what that tells us is we're never going to succeed at solving problems like this, at making technology that works for everyone, by trying to divide the world up, because the world doesn't divide up. Even if we could afford to make 50,000 different versions, it still wouldn't be enough buckets. So what we have to understand is that dividing is not going to be the answer here. What we have to do is treat this as a debugging problem, same as you would any other bug. You fix the bug to make the software better. So that's what we want to do here. Fix the bug that is preventing certain problem-solving styles from succeeding. Make it so all problem-solving styles succeed at some feature. That's the key. It's all about debugging. Okay, so where do bugs like this lurk? Well, everywhere. There's a paper, at least, about all of these. Open source project sites? Yep, there are these gender inclusivity bugs in the site, okay? Programming environments? Yes, in the environment itself, in the toolware. Spreadsheets? Oh, you bet. Mobile apps all over the place. Even help systems, okay? Because think information processing style, right? These things are ripe for gender bias bugs if you do them wrong. E-learningware. This is Canvas, which we use at OSU. I'll be using this one as an example. In fact, you're going to be getting to know a lot about the problems with Canvas very shortly. Websites, yes, it works for any technology, not just apps, okay? Even plain old websites have lots and lots of these inclusivity bugs. Digital libraries, oh yes, okay? In other words, they're everywhere. And as I said, there are papers about all of these and more. As academics, maybe we can relate to this. All the tech we academic people do business with, these inclusivity bugs are there. Admission applications, registration systems, IT support, web pages, SurveyMonkey surveys. Have you ever run across any of these things at Kane and been frustrated? Okay, and say, why? Yeah, okay. All right, so now you're saying, well, okay, what are these bugs? And that's what the GenderMag method is for. It shows you where the bugs, what the bugs are and where they are. Let's see, if anybody has a question along the way, by the way, feel free to just ask. Okay, so what is it? Gender inclusiveness magnifier is what GenderMag stands for. It's a method, it's a process. This is not a tool. We do have toolware to help support it, but what it is it's something you do, not something you execute, okay? The scope of this method is when the end user is problem solving with technology. And an end user is anyone whose eyeballs are on the keyboard, right? Or on the screen, anyone. So if they're asking questions like, how do I, or should I? If they're asking questions about the technology, like how do I get this thing done in this tool? Or if they're asking questions that they want the technology to help them with, like I'm trying to debug and I'm using a debugging tool, you know? And so I'm trying to get at the bug and is the tool being helpful for me? Or more, where is the darn bug? Okay, anytime you've got somebody scratching their head, GenderMag is in scope. Okay, so that's what it's for. What it has is these five cognitive facets, which you've already met. And these are put into the context of a gender specialized cognitive walkthrough. Most of you may not know that term, but I heard one or two people say they've taught HCI, so maybe you've heard about it. We've specialized that process in a way that embeds the facets and the personas into a process. If you don't know what that means, don't worry about it. Okay. We provide these personas. So yeah, you've met these people too.